Well, good afternoon, everyone, and it truly is a good afternoon. We're at Brooklyn Center Elementary. Want to thank Dr. Baker for welcoming us into this this facility. I think we're going to hear from some folks that'll kind of put some light on what we're doing out here. Yesterday was the first day that the vaccines were available for 5 to 11-year-olds. We saw the excitement at Mall of America's site, but as we've been saying, it's important for us to make sure that we're combining safety, speed, and equity. And that's taking vaccines to where kids are. That's why we set up 1,100 sites. That's why we have pre-positioned, and as we speak, more vaccines coming in. Commissioner Malcolm may speak about that. The hundreds of thousands that we wanted to be available for parents to go where they wanted to get this done, whether it be their local pharmacy, whether it be the Mall of America, whether it be with their pediatrician, or the one that makes a lot of sense to many of us, at their child's school, a place where they have trusted adults around them, they can get good information, and they can get that done and get on with what we know is the most important thing about this, letting kids be kids. And that's keeping them healthy, keeping them in the classrooms, keeping them engaged in the things that they can do. So we're super excited to see this plan is rolling out as we hope. We're here today, and I think Dr. Baker told me we have 175, is that correct, appointments, so you'll hear from that. Our parents are taking advantage of this. I'm grateful to those parents for protecting not only their own children, but protecting their neighbors' children, their neighbors, and the rest of our community. As many of the folks here, especially who follow this in the media closely, the northern tier of states are still going through a Delta variant spike. This surge has been pretty relentless. The numbers are not encouraging at this point in time, and it's at a point where if we do things right, vaccinations, layered mitigations, we can make sure that we're not reporting 41 people dying and over 1,000 people in the hospital because of COVID. And one of the big steps we're going to take is getting these little ones, these brave ones that are coming in here, to get that vaccine to make a difference. So you're going to hear from Commissioner Mueller. You're going to hear from Commissioner Malcolm. You're going to hear from Dr. Gagnon, Dr. Baker. And then I think you're also going to see Chloe with again, I think the greatest job title, zookeeper. Amanda Norby White is here from Como Park Zoo and Conservatory with a sloth. One of the things we're trying to do is create atmospheres where kids feel good about what they're doing and they understand. And as one of our pediatricians said yesterday, so much unknowns and so much uncertainty. A lot of our kids have gone through a lot of trauma. Now they're taking charge of this. They're in charge. They're getting their vaccines. They're in charge of stopping this. They're in charge of staying healthy. And that is incredibly empowering. And that's what that's why doing it at school makes it even a little bit better. So with that, I'm going to turn it over for maybe some of the specifics of how this works with parents to Commissioner Mueller.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for having us. Dr. Baker, thank you so much for having us at your school. And we are so deeply grateful to have the opportunity to have state sites that allow us to help to support our 5 to 11-year-olds in places and spaces where they know that they're comfortable, they have adults who care about them, and it's a location that they are used to. We know that the beginning of the pandemic, we've always started with thinking about the safety, health, and wellness of our students, staff, and families. And we have prioritized not only layered mitigation strategies, testing happening in our schools for students and staff, vaccines available to our 12 and up, and now we have the wonderful opportunity to provide that to our students who are aged 5 to 11. And it's incredibly important because it allows us to ensure that all of those who want to be vaccinated have the access to be able to do that, that we are in a place where we are able to provide that and to allow our families to know that they can do that in a setting of a school that they trust. We are deeply grateful for our partnerships with our schools and with our communities because we know that oftentimes our schools are a hub for our communities. And so in this partnership, if you're looking at a community school, this is another place where we are able to help to support our students and our families. We are also deeply grateful to be able to think about how are we going to now also provide this support across our state, and we have that partnership with our colleagues at the Department of Health. In addition to layered mitigation strategies, this is one of the best ways for us to keep our students and families safe. One of the things we want to be able to reiterate that's important to note is that it is important that we have the consent of our parents and our families for our students. It's not that it's going to happen in schools without any of our families or parents knowing. It's important for our family to provide that consent. And if you have the opportunity, we need you to be at school with your your students to be able to have them vaccinated with you. We know that that's why we are offering it before school. There are after school opportunities. There are weekend opportunities because families work at a variety of times throughout the day. And your ability to be able to be with your student is incredibly important. And so we are deeply grateful for the opportunity to be here today. We're thankful for our partnership with the Department of Health. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Commissioner Mel.
Thank you, Commissioner Mueller. Good afternoon, everyone. It's great to be here. And thank you to the superintendent for hosting us and to all the schools around Minnesota. We're really, really grateful for the interest that many of our school leaders, working with their local public health agencies in many cases, and with us at the state, to bring these vaccines to the schools. And I just want to, again, reinforce how very important and valuable the connection between schools and health has always been and is in this moment. Too often last year, we seemed to be debating whether we were going to prioritize health or learning. And this is the perfect combination of bringing those two things together. They were never in conflict, but this is our best way to support not only the health of our children and our teachers, but the broader community as well, and to keep the kids in school where they want to be. So we're just very, very grateful for the partnership that we have with the Department of Education, and also the Governor and Lieutenant Governor's Children's Cabinet have been just fantastic partners at helping us think creatively about extending this this vaccine ecosystem that we've talked so much about over the last year. But now bringing this to the schools just has so much value for this moment in time. As the governor said, we are still very much in the midst of this wave, and we know that unfortunately a lot of the recent spread is happening in younger children and from younger children to the broader community, family members and the like. So especially with year-end holidays coming up, this is such a critical time and a great opportunity to deepen the vaccine protection among our youngest and really help to support a healthy end of the year for all of us. So with that, my pleasure to introduce Dr. Baker, and thank you again.
Good afternoon. I'd like to express my gratitude to Governor Walz, Commissioners Malcolm and Mueller, as well as the Department of Health and the Department of Education. This opportunity for us today here in Brooklyn Center Community Schools is beyond measure in terms of its importance for our community. As a community school district, we serve a community that has foundationally a significant amount of mistrust for science, potentially for vaccines, and also is fraught with misinformation around the vaccine for their family, for themselves, and certainly for our smallest learners. Being given the opportunity to offer this clinic, where we have 175 young people scheduled to come in today between 12 and 7 to receive their first dose of their vaccine, serves as an example that can help to carry the story throughout our community in Brooklyn Center, as well as into our other communities that we serve across the metro area and across the state as we grow this. As Commissioner Malcolm referenced, we should never be forced to make a decision between the health and well-being of our young people and their learning. And this step today, as we start to be able to offer access to the vaccine, both here in my community, as well as across the state and across the country, takes away that forced choice. We have the opportunity now to be able to focus on great education here in Brooklyn Center, focus on taking care of the ever-present and ever-developing mental health concerns that our students can present with as a product of having been away from their school and their safe zone for nearly 2 years, to get back to the place where kids can be kids. And to the governor's point about our young people taking charge, I was standing at the door earlier here at the elementary, and a young man came through coming from recess. He had his mask down a bit, and I said, "Mask up, little man." And he goes, "I know." And he pulled his mask up and then turned around and said, "And I'm getting my vaccine today." And it was such a heartwarming exchange, and that is absolutely true our littles are taking control and they know what they want. And now it's up to us to make sure that, as always, we're providing access and opportunity for them to be able to have a voice and a say in keeping themselves, as well as the rest of our staff around our district, safe and happy as well. So thank you again, and thank you for bringing this opportunity to us, and I will turn it over to Dr. Gagnon.
Thank you, Dr. Baker, and thank you for including me. Good afternoon, my name is Dr. Madeline Gagnon, and I am a mother of these beautiful gentlemen and a local Minnesota pediatrician. I am here today with overwhelming joy and gratitude to be able to be here to vaccinate my sons. I come for two reasons: a simple act of love and the immense desire to protect my children. This vaccine now makes COVID-19 a preventable illness for children 5 and over. This vaccine, 1/3 the dose of the adult dose, is safe with very minimal side effects and is very effective. There were immune, robust antibodies shown 2 weeks after the second dose. So yes, it is true that most children sustain mild illness if they get infected with the COVID virus. But what we don't know is the long-term health implications. We are concerned about the long-term health side effects they may have as they age and develop. And now that's preventable. And unfortunately, some of our Minnesota families have had to be hospitalized. And devastatingly, some have lost their lives. Such tragedy does not need to happen any longer for children 5 and over. This disease is now preventable. As everyone has said today, kids want to be kids. They want to stay in school. They want to be on the soccer team. They want to have a sleepover. This vaccine now allows them to do that with less risk, less anxiety that they're going to get sick or make their friends sick. So today, again, I am here with overwhelming joy to vaccinate my sons. And I encourage all the parents out there to get their questions answered, to get the validation they may need from their trusted healthcare providers, and to consider vaccinating their kids for not only the safety of their kids, but all Minnesota kids. Thank you. I will turn things over to the governor.
Thanks, Dr. Gagnon. Yay.
Well, thank you, Dr. Gagnon. And I think, a pediatrician and a mother speaks to that, both the data that's there and how families are feeling. Having it in school is the right thing to do. And I think Commissioner Malcolm and I have been talking over this last week or so with the numbers we've seen, but looking forward to these days, because we really do believe this is a critical moment. And when the history of the COVID pandemic is written, I think the ability to be able to get our little ones vaccinated and the potential that that has to do to break some of this surge that we've seen and hopefully prevent future surges is what we have been looking for. So again, I will encourage Minnesotans, go to trusted sources, go to your pediatricians, get the information you need. We have made this as accessible and as easy and as barrier-free as possible across the state of Minnesota. Over these first few days, I'd ask for just a little bit of patience. The Minnesota.gov Vax for Kids site, you can go to and find some of that. But there are going to be plenty of vaccines over the next several days and the coming weeks, and they're going to be in some of the most convenient, trusted places. You get your little ones done with this and they get back to being kids. So with that, any questions of the group that's here? This may be for the commissioners to see if what we can do about expanding that. It's a great question, I think, and maybe Heather, I could have you talk about this. I believe we have 16 set up right now for this day and the next couple of days, but it's a great question. We want folks to be able to make it as easy as possible. So Jan or Heather?
Thank you. So what we know is that we have partnered with the Department of Health, and we have looked at who has the capacity across local public health. And we know that local public health have worked with their school communities, not only throughout this pandemic, but prior to the pandemic. And there is a lot of trust that is built up. And so we know that local public health is helping to provide these opportunities in schools, and there is essentially a timeline of being able to, as vaccines are coming in, to be able to get them out as quickly as possible and are going to be available in schools. We do have a number of state sites where we know that local public health may have been limited in their capacity, and so they need to augment that support. And so that is where we see things like we're able to do today with Brooklyn Center. But it's really important we know that not only schools, but having access to pharmacies, recognizing that your local pediatrician and your providers are also wonderful places to be able to get access to the vaccine. But we know that schools continue to be an important place in that, and our local public health partners in that are going to continue to be really important.
And then a little bit of a follow-up to that, is there anything that I know the vaccination is safe, but obviously in neighborhoods that's a big debate, like, am I going to get my child? What can we say to people that are maybe concerned still about vaccinating their children at age 5?
Okay. I'm going to hand that over, I think, to our pediatrician. Thank you.
Your mom and a pediatrician.
Thank you. Wonderful question. It's so important to get the correct information out there. This Pfizer vaccine has been well vetted. The current study had over 2,000 children in it, and there were additional children enrolled that do post-safety follow-up studies. As I mentioned earlier, this dose is one-third the dose that adults have received, those 12 and over. And so the goal there was to give the appropriate dose to elicit a good immune response, but to limit the side effect profile. So thankfully in this first round of trials, they certainly did not see side effects such as myocarditis. But certainly then the regulatory bodies such as the FDA and CDC then bring those measures into place to help vet that information. Certainly the studies will continue to follow children for their safety profile, but what I can say now is that the profile and known facts about the vaccine outweigh the risks of the COVID virus itself. And so certainly being vaccinated will help children remain safe compared to if they were to be infected with the virus. Thank you.
Commissioner, can I ask, the K-12 school numbers really plummeted today. It's kind of odd to see those numbers go way down at a time when the adult numbers, the overall numbers of hospitalizations are up. How can you explain the discrepancy between those? It's almost like two pandemics, and is that going to undercut selling vaccine to kids at a time when these cases are dropping?
Well, unfortunately, I don't think the cases are going to continue to drop. In the lag period, they're back up. So I think we always have to look at some of those data trends over time. There may have been, you know, some artifacts of less testing, MEA break, and so forth. So I wish I could say that we do feel that the cases are on a sustained trend downward, but it's just too early to say that at this point.
I think I would be able to get you that list. I don't have that right off the top of my head, all 16 of them. But we do know that we have been able to look across the state and really have representation statewide, not only within the metro area, but also looking in greater Minnesota to ensure that there is access. Also recognizing that there are some communities who are not within a 30-mile radius of or 30-minute radius of a pharmacy. And so really thinking about what that looks like across the state. And our local public health have been able to expand exponentially in their capacity as these 5 to 11 vaccines are coming in. And so we know, again, that this partnership continues to be incredibly important. Schools are one of the ways that we are going to be able to provide this. It is not the only way, but we also know this role that it plays in a community. They're happening this week across the state.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, we do expect that to grow. Well, a couple of things we've been able to look at is not only within the metro area, but in our partnership, it's always been with the Department of Health, it's always been looking at how can we do this quickly, how can we do this safely, and how can we do this equitably. And you heard the governor talk about that as well. Really being able to look at what that access looks like across the state of Minnesota, recognizing what we have availabilities for with pharmacies, is also looking at the total number of students who may have access or identified as needing free or reduced price lunch meals. And so really looking at what are our populations look like, not only in the metro area, but across the state, and really being laser focused in recognizing where we have capacity with local public health and where we don't.
Time for one more today, and then we gotta get these two back.
Governor?
Yes.
You got your back second dose last.
I had none. It's right. I was a Johnson & Johnson recipient with, at that time, with Governor Pawlenty out at the Vikings facility. And then last week we went and I chose to do the Moderna vaccine, as did Commissioner Malcolm. I had no side effects, a little bit of a sore arm, like I threw the ball a little bit too much for one day, and nothing like that. And so we'll, next Tuesday will be my 14 days, and a lot of the research shows that 14 to 15 days is where you reach kind of the maximum on it. So I certainly am grateful for that. I think we all know, while it's a small percentage, breakthrough cases are still real. And talking to people who've even received breakthrough cases, this is not an easy thing to get through. So it went well. Encourage, again, Minnesotans are in the top three nationally for boosters. I would say, and maybe have Jan comment on this, I think the really good news in combination with these little ones are the boosters with Moderna in our long-term care. Maybe we would say something on that one.
Yeah, thanks, Governor. That is an important development. When the Moderna and Johnson & Johnson boosters were authorized just a week ago now, that became really important for long-term care. As folks might remember, that was a priority population to get vaccinated first out of the gate. And in Minnesota, that was overwhelmingly with the Moderna vaccine. So we're starting to see some really good uptake of those booster doses in long-term care. And also happy to say we're seeing some steady increases in staff vaccination rates as well. I'm sorry, I am not familiar with that study.
Okay.
It's all
stuff. A colleague wanted me to ask the question. Thank you.
Okay.
Governor, well, do you have time for one more off-topic one?
Sure, we can do a quick off-topic.
Sounds like there's a long-standing opposition tribal community to sports gambling. Could this potentially be the year for sports gambling?
Yeah, I heard what I trust adults to do things. I think you have to do this right. I'm a little miffed at the legislature that we're talking about sports gambling. How about we get the essential workers and the drought stuff done, and then you can move on to your next topic. So I'll leave that one for another day, but there's work that's in front of us right now, and there's this work, and our work right now is going to be to take these two gentlemen inside, see a sloth, Chloe, and get you protected. So let's go do it.